God's answers. It must be in His holy word, and through His Holy Spirit I'll be assured. Got to get back to the Bible basics, the simple truth to be healed. Got to get back to the Bible basics. Don't complicate with my mind what God has revealed.
Well, good morning to you all, and welcome to a brand new day with Christ and a brand new week. You know, when we, our attitude, when we get up in the morning, determines how we take out the rest of the day. If we get up feeling lousy, feeling angry, feeling that the world is against us, then that's the way we will carry on through the day. But we know as believers that the world, that the non-believing world will be against us because of who we are. But we know we have a greater God that is for us. So just rise up and just say, well, thank you, Father, for such a lovely day. Thank you, Father, that I have what I need. Thank you, Father, that it's a great day. It's a new day. That I can start the day with joyous and knowing that your mercies are new every day. Thank you, Father, I can show somebody your love and your mercy today, that you have new things, new expectations of me today. Isn't that awesome, guys? And I know these past few weeks I've been discussing about knowing your enemy. And it is so important to recognize and see the enemy, which is not flesh and blood. Our enemy is a spiritual forces. It is Satan and his demons or his angels. But just remember, Satan does not, or his demons do not look like what Hollywood and comics portrayed him as, this cute little red devil with horns and his tail. You know, that's not Satan. Satan was created perfect. Everything he was beautiful. He was also known as a morning star. He had light in him. But God created him and the angels. But Satan fell down. He wanted to be God. And so how can a creation be greater than the Creator? It cannot happen. But because he sinned, because he wanted to be God, God had to deal with him. But Satan's influence went through a third of the angels. So be aware. You know, be very, very aware that Satan can appear to you and you might think it's from God. That you might feel, oh, this is an angel of light. But if it does not line up with the word of God, then it won't. It's not from God. It's from Satan. So guys, be careful. Many have been duped into believing what is not the truth. So please, guys, just remember, God did not create sin. Satan did that. Lucifer, Beelzebub are all one and the same person. So just to encourage you, remember, we are overcomers in Christ. We have already overcome in Jesus' name. Right. So, we were looking at knowing your enemy in places. in the family, in businesses, covetousness, the love of money. We're going to now look very quickly at the world of politics. You know, to be able to govern a country, it is one that we can really see what is governing, what is happening in the natural through governments. That is, and we can see the demonic power working through that. I mean, just the other day, I saw a flash news article that there was a minister was jailed and sentenced for rape. Can you imagine how much he used his influence as being a politician to do that? We see two incidents where demonic power or Satan has come against the biblical political world. Okay, so we see in the Bible there are two times where Satan has tried to take over, and we can see that he has taken over in the Bible. One was when Daniel prayed for 21 days. Daniel was on his knees, but he got his mouth, but an angel came after 21 days. It didn't take Daniel's prayer 21 days to get to God. It took Daniel's answer to his prayer to get to him 21 days. Why? Because there was a demons were holding the angel. An angel, guys, is a messenger from God. If you look at all the incidences of angels, they were bringing a message from God. And this angel had to go back to God, and God was then able to have to get an angel called Michael to come back. And we read this in Daniel 10, verses 12 to 13. And this is what it says. Fear not, Daniel, the angel speaking, for from the first day that thou didst set thine heart to understand and to chasten thyself before thy God, thy words were heard. Okay, so we can see the first day that Daniel set himself aside to pray, God had heard him. And I am come for thy words, but the prince of the kingdom, please note, this is not the physical prince of Persia, as we see, that Daniel was talking to an angel. Angels and demons exist in the spiritual realm. They can and does affect the physical realm. Okay, so let's carry on. But the prince of the kingdom withstood me 120 days. But, lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the king of Persia. So he had to wait until Michael, who is also known as a prince or an archangel, came and fought the prince of Persia, which is the demon, so that he could get through. This passage gives us an idea of what happens in the spiritual realm. But because of what Jesus has already done for us, we have dominion over Satan and all his angels and evil spirits or demons, whatever you want to call them. We have that power and authority because Jesus overcame him. We have the victory because of what Jesus did. The other example is Herod. He was controlled by demonic power. When you think about it, he didn't want anyone else to rule or to take over his place. He ordered, if you remember, when Jesus was born and the wise men came to speak to him to find out where Jesus was born. Now remember, that didn't necessarily all happen at the time of his birth. on the day or on the night that he was born. It could have happened between up to 2 years afterwards. And remember, it wasn't three wise men. The Bible doesn't speak about three wise men, but it does speak about the three gifts. So we always assume, we take the three and we put it to the men, but it just says wise men. So it could be more than three, or it could be more than, it could be two or more. So just realize that there was definitely more, you know, two or more, not one. So, and then, of course, they had not only the frankincense and myrrh and gold, but they also had the servants, the camels, and everything else that went with it. So it wasn't a very small party, it was quite a large party. But anyway, so Herod heard about Jesus' birth, and because he didn't understand who this king is, and he was fearful that he was going to lose his throne, and this fear, or this, he wanted to keep his throne. He wanted to rule Israel, which he really was, but he wanted to control it and manipulate it the way Satan wanted it. Herod was not a good king. What did he do? He ordered that baby, all the babies from the age of 2 years old and so from 0 to 2 years, to be killed. And we can read this account in Matthew 2:16-18. Can you imagine having your newborn baby ripped out of your hands and killed? Can you imagine how those soldiers must have felt, like having to kill a baby? How many of those soldiers might have had a child of their own? But they didn't go against the king's orders. They obeyed them. How sad is that? So we see politics. The demonic powers can operate in politics. And we see that more and more. Just look at the things that they have to deal with. The gender identity. The race identity, the class identity, but all of those things they've got to deal with. Religious identity, you know, they've got to deal with it. And it's quite amazing to see how they're doing it. So now let's have a look at, let's listen to a song. And this is who we need to trust.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He bursting forth in glorious day. Up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since Christ has lost his grip on me, for I am his and he is mine. Lord, in the precious blood of Christ.
Our next session we are going to be dealing is in the world of crime. Now we can see this everywhere and we know, but you know what, sometimes it's not always a demonic, okay? There are some crimes that are demonic. Okay, let me explain to you what I mean is all crime, okay, all things are done through, you know, it is not of God, okay? There is a demonic force behind it. But not every criminal is demonically possessed. And so as somebody who steals from you, sometimes it's out of their own greed. And greed comes from Satan, but they're not possessed by Satan. They just want money, if you understand what I'm saying. So some crimes are committed are not necessarily by a person who is, you know, demon-possessed, right? But there are crimes, and sometimes crimes are committed by those that are possessed by demons. So today, a modern crime is related to demonic power. And we can see this through loads of things that we see on TV and newspapers, which we'll get through with that. Isaiah describes the conditions we live in today. We can see it today. And we just read what Isaiah says. Remembering this was written quite a few years ago. It's in Isaiah 59, verses 3 to 4. For your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers with iniquity. Your lips have spoken lies. Your tongue has muttered perversiveness. No one calls for justice, nor does anyone plead for truth. They trust in vanity and speak lies. They conceive mischief and bring forth iniquity. Does that not sound like today? How incredible is our word of God today, for us today? How incredible is God's word? It is relevant, and when Isaiah wrote it, it is still relevant for us today, and it will be relevant for the time to come, until Jesus comes. But have you noticed more and more people, there's more and more murders that are happening, more and more people that are thieving and stealing, there are more and more, you know, lies being spread about, you know, so many things. I know when this whole child abuse thing erupted, and they, you know, against famous figures, and one of the famous figures that got accused was Cliff Richard of molesting somebody. But he was proven not guilty, and the person was just doing it so that she could get fame. And she was never molested by Cliff Richard. So you see how people are trying to claim on. That was a lie. Why? Because she wanted to be famous. But that didn't work. Okay? So they don't do that. Now, the value of life today is far less. And we can see that in the judgments today. So the value of life is less than the value of items. How often do victims of crime feel that it is not worth reporting crimes because they know that nothing is going to be done about it? Oh, you know, for example, just this past week, last Monday, early hours of the morning, my car and some of the cars around the road area, somebody had deliberately taken a pot of strawberry jam and a bag of flour and threw it on my car and other people's car as well. Now, nobody reported it. Why? Because we know the police will do nothing about it. Because they will just put it on a back burner and not do anything about it. Because there is so much more to be done. But this could have caused damage to the cars. Because if it had rained, what would have happened? The flour would have turned to glue, and would have cost us money to get it taken off properly without damaging the car. It could have damaged the paintwork to the car. And thank God it had not rained that night. Amen. So, in the last days, crime will increase. Even Jesus said it would increase. And we can see this every day. There was a time when it was safe for everyone to leave your house unlocked, to allow your children to play outside in the streets until it got dark. And here in the UK, in the summer months, you'll see that it'll only get dark at about 9, 10 o'clock at night. And you'll be amazed, you know, 10 o'clock at night, it's getting dark. And so children will be allowed to play out until 10 o'clock at night in the summer, remembering our summer is now while you guys are having the winter, which would be their holidays, okay? You could leave a bicycle outside and it wouldn't get stolen, those sort of things. But not today. You have to lock up everything, your house, your cars, your bicycles, so they wouldn't get stolen. You have to be aware of your surroundings, what's going on. Everything, but remember, everything we have belongs to God. And we have the ultimate security system. We have a heavenly security system that keeps us, you know, I often remember the books we read, the freedom we had, and I mean, I lived in a farming community as a child, but we used to read the books by Eden Blyton called The Famous Five, or The Secret Seven, and the freedom they had to go camping alone without the parents, and you wished you could be there, but it's not like that anymore. You know, it's not like that anymore. It's just so sad that the children cannot experience that anymore without having that freedom to do it. In Matthew 24 verse 12 says, because iniquity will abound, the love of many will grow cold. Because iniquity, pastors, preachers, teachers, evangelists, prophets, apostles, don't fall into traps. You know, if we were to read verses 9 and 11 of Matthew, which we'll do a bit later, but if we were to read those verses, we will see why iniquity abounds, that many will be persecuted, killed, hated for Jesus' name. All right? So you'll be persecuted, hated, killed for Jesus' name's sake. That's if you stay true to the faith. Because of that, all right, many will fall away, will betray each other, hate one another, false prophets will deceive. All these things will happen only because of crime levels have risen up. Don't we see that today? How many people can we say are truly true believers, or do they just act out? Let's read this verse. Let's read it properly from verse 9. So Matthew 24, 9 to 12. Then they will hand you over to be persecuted and will kill you, and you will be hated by all nations. That's you. You are a peculiar people. The Bible says so. Why? Because we think differently from the world. If you give money away, the world thinks you're crazy. You know, what are you doing? You hardly got enough, but yet you're giving it out. Guess what, guys? You're planting seed. You're planting seed. But they don't see it as you're planting. They can't see that you're planting your seed and you're going to get a harvest. They can't see that, but you're planting seed. All right, I'm using money as an idea because I know that's a concept my husband can't understand. When I plant seed, he thinks, hang on, are you paying, the ministry to work for them? That doesn't make sense. It should be the other way around. But you know what? He can't see that it's planting seed. It's giving to God, and God gives back to me. He who gives to the poor lends to God. All right? So, sorry, I digress. Matthew 24, 9 to 12. Then they will hand you over to be persecuted and will kill you, and you will be hated by all nations. Note the all. For my name's sake. Whose sake? Jesus' sake. This is Jesus speaking. Then many will fall away and betray one another and hate one another. And many false prophets will rise and will deceive many. Because iniquity will abound, the love of money, the love of many will grow cold. Grow cold. The word iniquity in the Greek, Strong's number is G458. It's anomia, which means illegality, that is violation of law or general wickedness, iniquity, transgressions of the law, and righteousness. Guys, we can clearly see that this does not only refer to man's inhumanity to man, but also extends and encompassing the last assault that Satan will have on the human family. This is what will happen to us, and if we are not careful, we will walk away from Christ, and we don't want to do that. Do you love God so much that you're willing to lay down your life for him? Even if your brothers and sisters give you up, the people that you love the most. I go out and I teach people and train people, and I've seen it. I've seen people turn away from the truth of the Word of God. And guess what? The most flack I get from is from believers. But I tell you what, my God is my God and my Father. You know what? I love him so dearly. And he's just so good. I don't have to fear anything. And fear brings you into bondage. It makes you a slave to what you fear. You know, if you fear something, get over it. And I'm learning to get over that fear. A fear of driving. Let's listen to a song.
Last night I lay a-sleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your voice and sing. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. And I, John, saw the holy city coming down from God. And I heard a great voice saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. And God himself shall be with them, and shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And then methought my dream was changed, new earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on its streets, the gates were open wide, and all who would might enter, and no one was denied. No need of moon or stars by night, nor sun to shine by day. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, sing, for the night is over.
Hosanna forevermore.
There has been so much increase of crimes being committed and strange delusions and compulsions. What I'm teaching you here, a lot of it has been taken out of Dr. Lester Summerall's teachings, and he gives us a few examples that he has come across and of people committing crimes, and they were saying, no, it's not they've heard voices telling them to do things, and they've done it. For example, like a mother strangling her little child and confesses in court that a voice told her to do it. One incident that happened that Lester Summerall was called to assess, and that was when there was a guy who had murdered somebody, and he claimed that it was a demon that told him to do it. He heard voices, everything, and the opposing team called in Lester to assess this guy, and he was known to be, it's on record in America, to be known to be an expert on demons and demonology, which he is. God taught him, in a way, it was really, really good way that, you know, God taught him. He traveled around the world and he learned about demons and demonology through God. But anyway, Lester Summerall was called in, and when he took the stand, he was asked, is this guy demon possessed? And Lester Summerall said, no, he's not demon possessed. And fortunately, he said the judge took that he was a wise judge and could see that this guy wasn't demon possessed. It was just a revenge, he just killed whoever it was he killed and was sent to joy into prison. But you say, but Megan, this is not happening today, that's in the past, or it's not happening in our country, you know. Well, I had just last year, on the 29th of October, a Dr. Barry Hansen, who worked at the Southampton University, which is about a 3-hour drive from us, was murdered by a 17-year-old boy. And the way he was murdered was really gruesome. The boy claimed it was the voices that told him to kill this professor, this doctor. Okay, not doctor as a medical doctor. He was a teacher. Right? So, this boy really killed him. That was just last year. This is not the only incident of this happening. There are people who have killed their own family. In London, this man grabbed a child and threw him off the balcony. And just the other day, I'm talking about half an hour's drive away from us, I've just read an article where a man claimed to the court in his testimony that he was a black witch, and that is why he raped and did bodily harm to a 70-year-old man. He was also accused of eating a woman's flesh. He was so full of pride when he proclaimed that he was a black witch, a black sorcerer, and an evil man. This only happened 27 kilometers away from where I live. His sentencing was done on Friday, the 30th of July, 2020. And if you could see the photograph of him, you could see the demonic on his face. You could see it. You could see the arrogance. No. I just can't believe. If you believe what the comics and Hollywood believe, what Satan looks like, i.e. with horns, you could almost see those horns on his face. But that smile that was there, it was arrogance, it was demonic. There was definitely a demon there. And it was loving the attention it was getting, even though it was negative. But I digress. I wanted to show you that crime has a demonic influence to it. But not all criminals are possessed with demons. Some just do it to get more money. Behind the compulsion to kill, there is an inner drive that is diabolical. This drive is a demonic power. But there is also a more subtle, pervasive spirit of the age which motivates people to do evil. Just look at the age we live in. Just look at the 1960s or 1950s. You know, it was a big shame if you were to go and be pregnant out of wedlock. There was a stigma attached to it. There was a stigma attached to gay and lesbian. There were, you know, relationships. There was those stigmas. And look at where it is today. There was stigma against abortions. But look where it is today. There's none of that now today. So you can see how we have to, you know, there is that subtle spirit of the age. It doesn't just motivate people to do evil, but it also forces you to accept things that are evil. But the good news is that we can counteract this force or demons. How can we do this? Well, first of all, Christ is greater than any power of any demon, of all the demons. Christ is greater. And we see this in 1 John 4:4. You are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because he who is greater than he who is in the world. We are greater, we little children. Little children. He is not demeaning us. We haven't grown up to our full potential yet. Even I haven't got there yet. But he's saying, you are of God, we are of God. We're not saying we are God, but we are from God. We are of God. Little children, we are children of God. And we have overcome them. Because he who is greater than he who is in the world. Christ is greater. And we're greater than he is in the world. The power that Christ has given us is greater than the power of our enemy. Who is Satan? Then Jesus can break the demon power too. So Jesus is, you know, power of our enemy. Who is Satan? Number two, Jesus can break demonic power over men. We see this. We see it all over. If we read the Gospels, you will see many accounts where Jesus dealt with demons. Matthew 12:28 is just one example. But if I cast out demons by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. Wow. The kingdom of God is about casting out demons. It's one aspect. So why are we sitting on our butts doing nothing? Get out there and let's cast out demons. These were the very words of Jesus. He was showing and teaching them a kingdom authority, which is that Jesus had authority or power over demons. Also, Jesus was pointing out that one kingdom is fighting another kingdom, and also that if a kingdom is divided, it will fall. Alright? So, if a kingdom is fighting amongst itself, it'll fall. But he's also showing that there is one kingdom fighting another kingdom. That the kingdom of God is fighting the kingdom of Satan. Jesus gave us authority over demons. Are you a believer in Jesus and what he did? If you're a believer, then you are a disciple. Then this is for you. You have no way out. Mark 16:17 says, these signs will accompany those who believe. There's no choice in this matter. It will follow. And what are these signs? In whose name? In my name, Jesus' name. They will cast out demons. Guys, you have no choice but to cast out demons. They will speak in other tongues. Many of you will be saying, maybe the tongues I speak, but not the casting out. Guys. Casting out the demons. As that is what the pastors or leaders' jobs are to do. So it's not up to me. Well, let me pose this question to you. If you believe that casting out demons is only for the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers, then why do you have the urgency to bring people to Christ? Is this not the job of the evangelist? In Mark 16, we just read, Jesus does not say that only those that are leaders can speak in tongues or cast out demons or preach the gospel. No, Jesus was talking to believers. Are you a believer? What is the highest person in the kingdom of God you can be? Would you say an apostle is the highest you can go? What would I say to you? That was not right. What would you say if I told you that was not right? The highest is that you first have to be a believer. You cannot be an apostle if you do not believe. Before you can even be part of the kingdom of heaven, you have to be a believer. So you should be already operating in all these things before you're an apostle, an evangelist, a prophet, a teacher, a pastor. You have to be operating in those things. Guys, that's how you can see whether a leader or your pastor or teacher is a true believer, because they're operating in those things already. You can never be part of an earthly kingdom or nation unless you are a citizen of that country. Luke 10:17 says, and the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the demons are subject unto us through your name. The demons are subject to us. What does that mean? It means we are their master. It's only through Jesus that I can say that I am Satan's master, because I can tell him and his demons what to do, and they have to flee or obey. It's not saying that I use Satan to do my bidding to heal people. No. You know, many non-believers do that. Witch doctors do that. I am setting people free. Satan has to obey me. I'm not reliant on him to do anything. I'm relying on Jesus. But he has to obey, because he's defeated. Because Christ in me, the hope of glory, is overpowering Satan's will and ability to do what he's trying to do. His thieving, his lying. All right, those that think that they can tell Satan and demons what to do and they're not born again, like the witches, the warlocks, the witch doctors, all of those in Raki healing, all of those, the Satanists, you name it, they think they are in charge, but they're not. They are enslaved to Satan. Satan makes them feel that they can tell the demons what to do, but in actual fact, Satan is their master. Satan is their master, not they be their master. The only reason why I say that I am his master is because I can tell him to get out or to footsie. You know, the British people don't understand that word, but it's so good because power seems to come out of it when you say, but I can command the devil to go. Good examples. One example is Lester Sumrall. He was in the Philippines when he woke up. His bed was against the wall, and he woke up because he felt his bed moving, and a demon had jumped into his room and moved his bed to the middle of the room, and he woke up and he said, "Hey, demon, go, get out and don't return." And as the demon hopped out the window, he said, "Well, wait a minute, get back here, move my bed back to where it was." So the demon came back, moved the bed back against the wall, and then left. So you see what I mean? You know, we don't have to fear demons. For goodness sake, don't fear them, because then you end up in bondage. You as a believer, you as a citizen of heaven, of the kingdom of heaven, you as a son of God, have every right to tell Satan and his angels or his demons or evil spirits to go and do not return. It is as simple as that. Do not, I repeat, do not get into a conversation with Satan. I pray that you've enjoyed learning about him. There is more to come. But, you know, I just want to encourage you guys. It's so awesome to teach you this, because I'm learning a lot and I'm seeing things happen. And I'm seeing my authority more and more in this area. Seeing where we can pray. We can pray that businesses will do dealings biblically. Praying for our government. Now we know what we can pray for. You know, Jesus tells us to pray for those in leadership. We can see, you know, we can see which ones are demonic in the criminal world. And cast them out, you know. So important, so important. You can be walking down the street and you get to recognize the demonic. And you see people disappear. And many, many people will confess that they know Christ. But do they truly know who he is? But before I go, if any of you want to ask questions, please feel free to contact me. I am on Facebook under Megan Harry Lockley. You know it's me because I have the one with the little light bulb. Ask me questions, send me messages, and also you can contact me on contactus@dtlm.org.za. And in this time, pray for every presenter on this radio show. There are times that the devil does not want things to get out there, and he will make things not work. So pray for everyone. Pray for those that spend time studying the word so at least they can get it out to you. Pray for your president. react opposite to what everyone else is reacting to. And right now, if any of you are sick, we command that sickness to go in Jesus' name. If finances has been stolen from you, we command those finances to be returned back to you right now in Jesus' name. Those that are demonically oppressed, we command the demons to leave you now in Jesus' name. And I speak peace and life to you. Amen.